All right, so we are just past the second major stage of the painting, which is, I call it the sepia stage, but really it's, I used a couple of different colors here. It's really what the drawing stage. It's where you're figuring out exactly how all your figures look, which way everyone's looking, how the hands are, basically all the details, so that the next phase, which is color, will go more smoothly, where all you have to do is worry about what color goes where, and you don't have to worry about the way you drew someone's nose. It's kind of all figured out. So in terms of what I did, I used white and sepia. Those were the two main colors, and then I also mixed up green to just take care of the secondary light source, which is the green gas that everybody's choking on. So that's all coming from the bottom, and then I have just kind of an amorphous light up in the top left. And so one of the things I did for the first time with this painting was used almost exclusively 3D models that I had made in Sculptures. So here I made my own material. You can kind of paint however you want things to look. So it comes with default things like just regular clay. You can make something look like gold. I made my own specific to this painting, which I just labeled 12. And so I used this model almost for everyone's hand. Everyone basically has the same pose with just a few minor exceptions and transformations. So, almost each and every single one, that's just... What really matters is the hand's relationship to the body and the person who's making the gesture rather than the way the fingers are. And then, of course, I have some fists here and there. And then other than that, I have I used kind of like a generic male face and a generic female face. And then also I used Photoshop's 3D capabilities to do the guns. So I got a model of a Colt 1911, and then today I just got a model of a Thompson submachine gun, which is that one right there. And it's upside down, because the character is upside down, but it's just easy enough to put it all in the same space with the same lighting. And this is all done in Photoshop CS5 extended version, which has 3D capabilities. The next stage is really just all about color. And the way I go about doing that is using my palette here. It's all done in gouache with a little bit of acrylic, but mostly gouache. Touches of watercolor. It kind of depends on what I want to do. If I want something that is... that I want to eventually glaze over, then I use acrylic first and then go back over it with more acrylic. If I want to maintain the ability to edit things after I put it down on the painting, then I'll use gouache, because you can always pick gouache back up. So basically this entire painting, everything that I've done so far, was all done in gouache, with the exception of the yellow, which is watercolor. And the reason I like that is because watercolor does not have as much body. And so when you add it, particularly with yellow, it will change the hue without changing things like value. It gets into the problem of undertone versus mass tone, which is a whole nother subject. But basically when I do the next phase, which I'll show under the time-lapse camera, I will arrange my palette in kind of a mimic of the painting that I want here. All right, we just finished the first section of painting. Got up, started at 8:30, it's about noon now. And started laying in some color. And basically what I'm trying to do is get the painting to look like my digital color study, which is tough to see, it's on my screen there.
which is of course pretty glossy. But all I'm really doing is trying to map out the colors that I'm going to need in order to start doing the final touches. So I've done pretty much all of the drawing that I can previously in the sepia stage, and now I'm just trying to match the colors that I want for the final. So if we look over here, this is my palette. This is generally the way that I arrange my palette. I've got white over in this corner and black over in this corner, and I usually keep sepia and burnt umber up here. I usually have two kinds of red, at least, a warmer and a cooler, alizarin crimson. In this case, that's pure red. The Holbein gouache. And then down here we have, I think it's just called dark green. Usually two kinds of blue, one warm, one cool. In this case it's ultramarine and what Holbein calls blue pure. And then over here we have lemon yellow. I've been using a lot of lemon yellow in this particular painting, mainly because there is so much green gas everywhere. So no matter what is in the painting and no matter what depth or position, everything has a little bit of a greenish cast to it. So almost all of the colors that I'm putting down, with the exceptions of maybe some of the bright spots where the other light is hitting it, maybe right here, the pink of his cape and his gloves, some of those don't have any yellow in them, but most everything else does. I have started doing the final passes on some of the figures. That one right there in the background is Dynamic Man. He's pretty much done. I'm not quite happy with the face, but it might just have to be good enough for now. The hands are pretty much done. Right now I'm working on this guy down here, the Fiery Mask. It's not quite focusing. While I'm working on him, I've got a whole section of my palette devoted to just skin tones, and I use the term lightly because these are all pretty green, not what most people would consider flesh tones, but in the course of my painting, the kind of color world that it's in, everything has a greenish cast to it. So I've set things up so that they go darker over here. This color right here, it's actually showing up a lot lighter on the screen than it is in reality. That is my second darkest green, and that's what most of the background is filled with. So I'm kind of using it as my darkest color, but as my darkest color, it also signifies that there is gas between us, the viewer, and wherever that shadow is. So you can see that color right here in the context of the painting. It looks like this, and again, it's showing up brighter here than it is in reality, but that's usually just the way things are. Gouache can be tough sometimes because there's such a discrepancy between what you end up mixing and what it dries to be, because when the water evaporates from the pigment, there's usually a shift, not so much in hue, but most definitely in value, but sometimes also in hue and saturation. But as I was saying, this guy, Fiery Mask, is next on the list. He's just about done, and I thought I'd show some of the reference that I've got going. So the middle head figure right there is just my generic male head. I lit it in Photoshop with two lights, and I used the ray tracing segment so that I could actually catch some fairly realistic shadows. I mean, obviously I take liberties. Same thing with the hand, and then over here on the right I just have some general reference. It's a character drawing by Chris Weston.